time into a much heavier Zoom time or something. Anyway, I'm Tom Kinzer, the president of the Bedford Historical Society, and I would like to welcome you to this meeting of the Bedford Historical Society. This is an informational meeting for members where we present programs about historical things related to our town and its past. And they're always interesting. And today we will have Sharon McDonald talking about a couple of very interesting Bedford citizens of the past. So Sharon, I would like to turn this lectern over to you. And our people over there will continue trying to bring back our Zoom audience as best they can. Sharon?
Well, I'm going to take my mask off, is that all right?
Yeah.
I'm delighted to be here, and I'm delighted that you came. Usually you say, you know, could you come to the front, could you get in? But this is good, you have to spread out because of the virus, that you've done the right thing. I advertised for, but it went too long, so I am going to give you 3 people this time and save the other one for the next time, hoping I'll get invited again. So this is 3 Bedfordians of the 19th century. And the first one is Anne Eliza Bacon. She liked to go by Eliza, so I won't call her Anne Eliza. She lived in the common. She lived just right about over there at the corner of South Road and Maple Street. That was her house, and her father was Reuben Bacon, who was quite a shoe manufacturer. He had other people making shoes for him, quite a number. And his grandfather, was Thompson Bacon, who was an inventor, a very successful inventor, who lived down the road, just a couple of houses. The big white house with the pillars, that was Thompson Bacon's house. Now, Anne Eliza loved music, she loved poetry, she loved drama. She would go to Boston and stay for a week or so and just go every night and every afternoon to a different production. And she also went to Lowell. Lowell was also a place where you could find concerts. And there she gave piano lessons. And there she sang in a chorus and eventually directed the chorus. Now, how do I know this about her? I know this about her because she kept a journal that she called Pencilings. And in her pencilings, she wrote pretty nearly everything. And we have here a book called Choice Seed in the Wilderness, which is from the diary of Anne Eliza Bacon. And I'll read you some in a little while. So let me see. Anne Eliza met Joseph Potter. Can you see where this is going? They started courting. They wrote passionate letters to each other, as passionate as you can get in the 19th century. And she brought him to Bedford, to introduce him to Bedford. Joseph arrived about 9 in the morning. My heart assuredly gave him its most cordial welcome. On the afternoon, we rode up to our famed Bedford Springs. We went into the new hotel, now erecting on the ground, and took a survey from the basement to the attic. The view from the observatory is really very pleasing and extensive beyond what I had supposed. After taking a full survey of the grounds and a choice draft from the spring, we returned home on the Billerica Road.
That's Anna.
Aunt Eliza and Joseph. Well, Joseph had an uncle who owned land in Wisconsin. And he was having trouble with the land. People were cutting trees on his land and hauling them away and building log cabins with them. So he sent Joseph to Wisconsin to take care of business. And Joseph did, and wrote back letters to Aunt Eliza. And she was so, her heart was so moved by all these letters. When he returned, they were courting and then decided to marry with the understanding that she would go with him to Wisconsin. Now you're gonna think this is not gonna end well, but it does. It does. Hang right in there. Now you know Laura Ingalls Wilder, the Little House on the Prairie books and the TV show that they had. She went to Wisconsin 10 years after Eliza Bacon did. So you can kind of figure out what you pictured in the Wilder stories and take that back 10 years. She packed up, and before she left for Wisconsin, she went to Boston, went to concerts. "Oh, when shall I hear the music of Beethoven again?" she said. So before she left, the very day she left, she went, "What is happening here? Am I doing something? Sabrina, am I doing something weird?"
"No.
No, I'm okay." Well, she went to the music store and bought a piano, her very last day in Massachusetts, and shipped that piano west. She went on the train to Albany, then on the Erie Canal down to Buffalo, and then in a boat, a ship, around Michigan, down to Wisconsin, and then by wagon. And by gummy, that piano made it too. She had her piano. Now she landed in Cooksville, Wisconsin, which was a tiny little town that had only been founded about 5 years before, and it had all of 100 people in it. But Cooksville very soon developed culture. They had a library, they had a dancing school, and they had Eliza giving piano lessons. She worked hard. It was a wheat farm until the chinch bugs came and ate all of the wheat. So Joseph turned to tobacco and fancy turkeys. When the transportation was better back east, they would send the fancy turkeys back on the train to New England, keeping New England in fancy turkeys. She had quite a number of farm hands, they had, especially during the harvest, and she would have to feed them all of the farm hands, all of her family. She had four kids, and all of the visitors who would come to see them. One day she penciled 31 for dinner.
Ooh.
That's a lot.
Yes.
That's a lot. There was a storm that blew up. Once, when Joseph was away, and she wrote about it in a, I was, oh my God, what a storm it was. I was terrified. Nope. "During a 5-day absence, when Joseph made a trip to Milwaukee, a blizzard built up, and left alone, Eliza wrote, the wind rose to a perfect fury and threatened to turn the house topsy-turvy, or to say the least, to beat in our windows. Throughout the day it raged without abatement, and this evening continues its melancholy music with a boisterous tongue. So, let me see, when her children got older, they put together a program of classical music and popular music and took it to towns in the neighborhood of Cooksville. And their favorite, often requested piece of music was the HMS Pinafore. She made 5 trips back to Massachusetts to visit family and to buy piano strings. Her mother visited her, and her neighbors, when they were interviewed later, said, "Eliza is unique, talented, vivacious, colorful, full of the joy of life." But one who was a child at the time just said, "We just knew she was someone we loved." And that's Ann Eliza Bacon. Now, I wondered if you had questions. I can repeat them if you have questions. "Wait a minute," says she. "Wait a minute."
Answer
the question. This is a picture of Ann Eliza.
Mm-hmm. And I'm just going to hand it to you. And you can sit around. How many children did she have?
4 children.
Yes.
Tell me, Miss, how did she and Joseph meet?
She and Joseph met in Boston, going to a party of a mutual friend.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And you've walked And who in this period was actually playing Beethoven concerts?
In Boston.
In Boston.
Yes, I don't know, but I think it was quite common to have Beethoven concerts in Boston. Well, I have another.
Sharon, could we stop just 1 second?
Mm-hmm.
The microphone is no longer functioning. Could you tap it and see if it's there?
Just hit the end of it.
I see Sabrina does this.
That's actually the mistake because you're loud.
Well, this is fun.
It's amazing, actually.
Sharon, while we're waiting, how did you select Liza as one of the 3 folks that you wanted to talk about today?
I selected Eliza because I already had the book.
Oh.
And I'd read the book, and I thought, oh, this is cool. I should talk about her. We have lots of Bedford people who stay in Bedford.
Right.
And she went west and never came back. Yeah.
And Sharon, perhaps you said this, but what were the dates of her birth and death?
Her birth, she went west in 1857. So she was born in like 1830. And lived until 1890, I think.
Who were her parents? Who were her?
Reuben and Elizabeth Bacon.
Sharon, was there any mention of what her grandfather invented?
He invented, help me with this, he invented blind
spring-loaded window holders. Mm-hmm. Open the window.
And hold it up.
They would keep the window open.
And carriage brakes or carriage springs?
Was it the plow? Snow plow?
Oh.
Or is that somebody else? Sorry.
But by the way, he's the one who moved his carriage house from South Road over to the Great Road when he built, that's Jonathan, right? Talk about Jonathan or Reuben?
No, I'm talking about
because Jonathan is the one that invented the fastener. He built the big house on the Great Road that has the big two-story Ionic columns.
Uh-huh.
And he moved his, he had been living on South Road, and he moved his carriage house from South Road to his property on the Great Road, which many years later was subdivided, and the carriage house is the house that the town wants to demolish to build a new fire station. It was built in 1836. And I hope everybody comes to town meeting and votes against it.
He had a billiard room, which got moved to a house on School Way, and the floor is still gorgeous. They promised to invite me over so I can see that floor, Thompson Bacon's floor. And another outbuilding was moved down and made into Express Pizza.
Oh.
It sort of broke up the house and put it all around, but the pillars are still there.
Mm-hmm. And which house on School Street, do you
remember? There's the big red one on the corner, yeah. The next one in.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. I won't say her name, but you know. Well, you're hearing me now.
But the problem is that the people who are Zooming won't be able to hear you.
As long as she speaks to them directly.
Oh, okay.
Or are we on Zoom now? Are we functioning?
Yes.
Well,
yeah,
we
all see the...
I imagine the answer would be different if you were saying when she moved there versus when she died, but mm-hmm. how long would it take at any given point in that time to get if she traveled back to Boston or her mother visited her,
how long of a journey from Bedford to Cooksville was about 2 weeks the first time she went.
Wow.
Just sliding down that Erie Canal.
Wow.
May I go on? All right. Let's do Edith Lane. Edith Lane was a Bedfordian, and unlike Eliza, she lived all her life in Bedford. Now she lived, picture Wilson Park, which is the crossroads where North Road and Concord Road and Great Road come together. One house, Bedford Farms, the yellow house, the next house up, that's where she lived. And her father was Oliver Lane, and he was a carpenter. And his carpenter shop was the little red house that decorates the barn door for every holiday.
Yeah.
That was Oliver's carpenter shop. She's very much connected to Bedford, Edith Lane, a descendant of Job Lane. So that anchors her in Bedford. Let's see. One of the things Oliver Lane did was to build this platform.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And do I say when? Nope. Built the platform. Edith, when she was older, was the secretary to the president of American Powder Mills Company, which was over in Maynard. Now, how do you think she could get from Bedford to Maynard and back every day? Horseback? No. Carriage? No. Train?
River?
No. The river? She went by streetcar. She went by streetcar. Remember the streetcar? You just go up to Concord, West Concord,
down the manor. But I'm not here to tell you about Edith as a as an older person. She this is so funny. I want to tell you about the 70th centennial.
Everybody wants to be on stage.
Yes, Oliver Lane stage. I'm going to keep going. This takes place during the sesquicentennial. Sesqua is 1.5. Centennial is 100 years. So 150 years anniversary of the founding of Bedford. Now it was a really big deal. Oh my goodness. I'm gonna let it sit on the podium so it doesn't look better. This is her essay for school. She's 11 years old. Bedford celebrated her 150th anniversary August 27, 1879. Her birthday occurs September 23rd, but as August 27th was more convenient, and also the day that the legislature met, it was concluded to have it then. I woke about 5 and ran to the window to see the Concord artillery pass. Then a little afterwards, the boom of the cannon and the ringing of the bell was heard. Then I went up to my friend's house to wait for her to go to the hall to wait for the barge. You know about the barge, when you go back and forth to school, you're in a wagon which is long and skinny and has benches alongside, so the kids go up the back and sit on the benches. In the winter, they take the wheels off and put sleigh runners. So the barge. At last it came, after we had waited until our patience was nearly exhausted. Then we girls clambered in and rode to the station to wait for the procession to form. Then Governor Talbot came, and salutes were fired by the Concord artillery in honor of his arrival. The procession formed at 9 o'clock, and after marching through the streets as far as Mr. H. N. Hunt's in the North District, which was one of Yale's large ones, being 200 feet long by 50 feet wide. It was erected back of W.F. Frost's stable on land owned by Mrs. Fletcher of Arlington. Now, is this going to be where Right at Home is, that big empty place? Mrs. Fletcher did own that. Let me see. Land owned by Mrs. Fletcher of Arlington. And it was divided into 2 parts, one part of the tent being for the dinner, the other for the oration, which was delivered by Reverend Jonathan F. Stearns, D.D. of Newark, New Jersey. And I have a copy of it, which I didn't bring you. It's about that thick, both sides. After seeing the dinner, which is the largest one I ever saw spread, I went to the flying horses, paid a man 5 cents, and then got on one the next chance and thoroughly enjoyed myself for about 5 minutes or so. Then I roamed around for a while until I came to the ice cream tent. I thought I would go in and have one, so I did, and thought it very nice, although it was rather a cool day for ice cream. I occasionally went to hear the oration, but not caring to stay long at a time there, soon came out. After dinner, I went to the tent to hear the toasts. I only heard a few of them, but among the few, I liked Governor Rice's best. Then I went to the grammar school room to see the antiquities, of which there was a large and rare collection, which would be here in the town hall, the grammar school room, yes? In the evening, I went to the tent grounds to hear the band concert and see the fireworks. The concert was very nice, and so also were the fireworks, especially the last one, which was Good Night with Bedford under it, and in the left lower was 1729 and the opposite corner 1879. I did not see that as I was in the ice cream tent. Thus ended the centennial and a half at which I, Edith L. Lane, had a splendid time and will ever keep it in remembrance. So that's Edith Lane.
I think our tricentennial committee will have a challenge meeting that.
Yes, yes. Our tercentenary is, of course, 2029, so it's sneaking up on us. If you got any ideas? Well, I promised this would be quirky, and it hasn't been quirky so far, and I tell you, it's not going to be. And I promised it would be quirky, so I thought, I'll just insert a couple of quirks in here so that you can go home and say that you actually did. These are from the town minutes,
the annual town report.
And it's fabulous that Ashley Large, who's the archivist for Bedford, has put all of these on with the aid of an assistant, put all these online. So if you want to go back to 1860 and see what the town, what the poor farm was doing or something like that, it's there. Now let me see. I wanted to read you, who here has been a select person? You have.
No.
No?
No.
Bill. It said, the selectmen submit the following report at the close of the financial year 1892-93. There has nothing occurred during the year of a nature different from the usual order of affairs.
You've never heard select board members be so succinct in your life.
Yes?
You're on.
Just ignore me and keep talking.
Ignore the man behind the curtain. This is Town Hall, which is this building, which has become Old Town Hall. We have also on this floor a small hall, suitable for a great many purposes. A fireproof vault for the keeping of valuable records, a janitor's room 10 feet square, and a lockup where a person, if shut up in it during some of the weather this winter, would wish he might be excused. Oh, the next thing to be considered should be a different way of heating the building. We would advise going slow, but the time is near when a different method from the one now in use will be adopted. Go slow. And the other one, you need a bathroom joke, right? I mean, you can't have a speech without a bathroom joke. And this is 1883, on account of the utter impossibility of keeping the privy in the boys' department in the center of town in a cleanly condition, the school committee asked of the town an appropriation sufficient to build a privy which shall be kept locked, except when necessary to be used by a scholar, and using the present privy for a urinal and no other purpose. My last Bedfordian is Abram English Brown. This is he. Abram English Brown is to me an odd name, but Abram Brown was very, very common. Abram Brown as a name was very common back in the 1850s or so. So I think that's why his parents named him Abram English Brown, so that he would be differentiated from all the other Abram Browns over the United States. Now, he's my favorite, I think, because he researched Bedford, and I researched Bedford. And I think of him pouring through the microfilm, you know? Yeah, just like I do. He was born in 1849. He lived always in Bedford, and his ancestor marched with the Minutemen on April 19, 1775. Now his father was a butcher, and he lived at the four-way stop. Are you Bedfordian enough to know where the four-way stop is? Page Road, Springs Road, Pine Hill Road, Springs Road. That's the four-way stop, and that's where he lived. I think he must have had a difficult childhood, because when he was 1 year old, his mother had a mental breakdown, which occurred four more times in their lives, and I think he must have not had a lot of support from his mom, that's what I think. But he attended Bedford Schools, this building. Primary was on the ground floor, and the grammar school was on the second floor, and this was a meeting room and a room where you could have potluck suppers and you could... Anyway, he was quite bright, and his uncle said, I'll send you to college. And his father said, no, he couldn't stand the pressure. And he gets headaches. So he didn't get sent to college, which I think is amazing, because he writes so well. What can I say? So instead of going to college, he went to work in a store in Burlington for 4 years. There was a library in the store, and his employer had a library, so he was in heaven. But after 4 years, his brother Alden died. And he got called home to work in the butcher shop. He drove the meat wagon. And then his father died in 1873, and he could become a school teacher, which he did, and met Sarah Flint, who was also a school teacher, and they married and lived at 44 Springs Road now. There's the big white house at the fork. One down, two down, three down is 44. I numbered these pages. Here they are. He was a newspaper reporter in the census. You know, you have to put down what your job is, and he put down butcher when he was a butcher, but now he puts down newspaper reporter. He was first reporting in the Concord and Lowell papers, and then he started his own paper. Rand has discovered tattered pages of it. You know Rand, who's the reference librarian at the library? This is Rand, yes. So, I say he loved Bedford, and he was highly offended when an article came out in the Lowell paper that was critical of Bedford. This is April 10th, 1885. 20 years ago this spring, an article appeared in the Lowell Journal which we which was in substance as followed. The town of Bedford, within 14 miles of Boston and 12 of Lowell, between Lexington and Concord, of 1,000 inhabitants, has no communication with the outside world aside from an old yellow bottom coach, has no resident clergyman, no MD, and all of its schools are taught by females. Indignant at such a showing up of a stripling of 15 years, says Abram, appealed to several people of maturity to vindicate Bedford, but failing to stir them to the action, tremblingly ventured himself. The real outcome of this has been the Bulletin, his newspaper. How different the record that can now be made of Bedford, united with the two mentioned cities by rail, the old yellow coach gone with the one-horse shay, three flourishing religious societies, two heavy resident pastors, a core of efficient teachers and well-supported, and the local matters well served up in home papers. Say not that old Bedford makes no progress. He began to make lectures. One on Faneuil Hall was described in the Worcester paper as an attractive story, pithy address on Faneuil Hall. He also wrote Beneath Old Roof Trees and Legends of Old Bedford, Whence Came the Witch of the Shawsheen Legend, which I hold forth for, but not today. His masterpiece, of course, was The History of Bedford, and I have a copy. This is my copy of Bedford that someone who knew I loved Bedford history gave me. And it's very easy to use because the pages come right out. So I won't pass it around, but I'll leave it up here and you can come right up and see it if you like. I'll leave it right up here. Oh, when he wrote his book, the town of Bedford bought 150 copies of his book. Now, I would like to put into Bedford Selectman's ear that I've written a book of history of Bedford, and I would be glad to sell 150 copies to the town. But I have some right over here if you feel like having your own copy of one of my books. Hey. Yeah.
I always thought it was interesting that A. Brown wrote about the history of town, and then Louise K. Brown wrote, but they are not related at all, right?
They're not related at all, right. Louise K. Brown, the K is for Kierkegaard. And her parents came from Denmark. She married Mr. Brown, whose family came from Rockingham, New Hampshire, going back generations and generations. So there she was, as I, someone who came to Bedford and fell in love with it and started writing. So I was going to bring some copies of Abram's History of Bedford, which has been republished and is available at the library. But really what you need to do is wait a few months. Alethea Yates is making an edition of the Bedford history. Do you want to talk about it?
It's going to be the annotated history of Bedford. There's a lot of very valuable information in there, but it's hard to read nowadays. And we're breaking it up into smaller pieces and adding information that people people don't have anymore. It's things that need to be explained. He assumed information that we don't have anymore, and there's, it would be a lot more readable and helpful, I think, mm-hmm. and lots of photographs.
Mm-hmm. So I would say wait until maybe Bedford Day, maybe it'll be out.
Hoping
out for Bedford Day, and buy that book. That's what I think. And Abram, was a founder and a secretary of the Historical Society. He was a library trustee. He was instrumental in getting the Union School built. He was the town clerk. He was a zillion things. I'm almost done. But the finest of all, at his eulogy, when he died, his eulogy, the minister, Reverend William Batt, said, A.E. Brown was trouble man. And I thought, is there a scandal that I didn't find in this whole thing? No, he said, trouble man. In Bedford, if you had trouble, you went to Abram Brown. He was generous, he was wise, and he was the trouble man. So that's where I'll end my speech.
Yeah, did he discuss the Bedford flag at all?
He did. He discussed the Bedford flag. He thought that the Bedford flag, if you're into the Bedford flag, it used to be thought that it was made in 1660. As the troop of horse, the Massachusetts troop of horse, Massachusetts Bay troop of militia. I wasn't ready for this. and he wrote it that way and later discovered that it wasn't that flag. It was a more recent flag, which indeed I agree with. It was made somewhere around 1710, not 1660. Yeah, he knew everything. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Any more questions? I must say that...
Tom, there was one in the back.
Oh, there is one. Okay.
I was wondering how Ms. Lane's essay was preserved.
How Miss Lane's essay was preserved. She was very interested in Bedford history and very active in the Historical Society all her life. She lived in 1955. And I'm sure finding this among her papers that, the Historical Society would like to have this. I'm sure that's what she did, because she was really into the Historical Society. Yeah. So if you have papers that you think are cool,
well, my apologies for what I think is an absolutely wonderful presentation and a thoroughly unwonderful read. With all of the attempts to try to make this stuff work, you people certainly got to hear and see most of it. The people on Zoom got to hear and see little of it, I'm afraid. And this whole business of trying to do hybrid meetings is just, it's really a puzzle. And we'll try to do better for next time. Other than that, I have nothing else.
The next program is the
guy from Channel 5, what's his name? He does Chronicle? Ted Weinstein. Oh. I think it's his presentation on general stores, general stores in New England. It's not all Bedford, but it's around New England. And it's a very good presentation, which I actually saw once upon a time, maybe 5 years ago. It was done at the library with almost no advertising. So my wife and I and Kay Spofford were the only people who showed up, which I thought was terribly embarrassing. So we will let him do it again, and hopefully more people in Bedford will get to see it.
Will that just be in person?
It will probably, it seems to me, Carol, that the future lies in the fact that we're going to have to do hybrid meetings from now on, simply because people do participate who simply couldn't come to an in-person meeting. But my apologies, I've got to find what we need to do to do a heck of a lot better job at this. Because you deserve better, and especially the people who come in and vote deserve better. It will be the last Sunday, and it will be 4 weeks from now, the last Sunday in March. March looks just like February, of course, until the last 3 days. So on the 27th of March, Ted Weinstein on the general school. And with that, let's call this meeting adjourned.